Okay, we are ready to start. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our series of colloquia of the Department of Physics and Astronomy. So I recall everybody that we are streamed online, and you can view the recordings of our colloquia, this as well as the previous ones, in our channel, YouTube channel of the Department of Physics and Astronomy. And I strongly encourage everybody to make comments or ask questions. We will have a session, discussion session at the end, and especially students are warmly welcome to contribute. Actually, the contribution of everybody is welcome. And a little commercial, we have almost a colloquium per month. The next one is scheduled on the 23rd of November by Matthias Neubert from the University of Mainz about theoretical perspectives in particle physics, past, present, and future. And now I'm very happy to welcome our today's speakers, Elisabetta Baracchini from the Gran Sasso Science Institute. So Elisabetta Baracchini is young but a very well-established expert on dark matter searches and especially the development of novel technologies for directional reconstructions with time projection chambers. But her career started working on low, medium energy accelerators, particularly at the electron-positron collider. And she went through several stations as a postdoc at the University of UC Irvine, and then Keck in Tsukuba, as well as University of Tokyo in Japan. So you covered several stations on the planet. And then she won a Marie Curie Fellowship. This is one of those funding instruments by the European Research Councils devoted to the support of, let's say, bright and young initiatives. And there she worked on the development of novel detectors. And this led actually to, later on, a consolidator grant by the European Research Council. These are extremely prestigious and very difficult to achieve funding. And this in collaboration also with INFN, which led to the development of a novel technology, and their success is acknowledged through the spokesmanship. So she's the spokesperson of one of the projects that she's going to illustrate to us today. And okay, you will guide us through the searches for dark matter with novel technologies. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot for this very nice introduction from you. And thanks a lot for having invited me here to talk to you about directional dark matter searches. And eventually, at the end of this introduction, the Cygnonicium project that is the, let's say, the realization of this ERC Consolidator grant. Okay, so let's start from the top. So we know that this is a dark universe. So we live in a dark universe. So in order to make this understandable for people from Padova, I'll show you if the universe was a spritz, what we would know of the universe, it would be just the little foam on the top and everything else would be unknown, okay? So in reality, what we are talking about, so this is one of the most recent measurements and from this is picture from the NASA. And the idea behind this, what I'm trying to say is that we, the universe that we live in, actually we observe it to be gravitationally dominated by an obscure form of matter that behaves in a completely different way with respect to the common matter that we experience every day on the table, in the air, or whatever, okay? So I would like to start this with an archaic example of dark matter. This is also the start, the way that I start my PhD lecture, because I think that this is very informative in trying to understand what is our understanding and our idea of what dark matter is, okay? So in the late 19th century, there were astronomers studying the movement of planets in our solar system, and in particular, Leverrier and Adams, they were studying the movement of Uranus, okay? And they observed an anomalous motion, which they could not explain just by using the simple Newton gravitational law. And so they inferred the presence of another object, okay, that was creating this modification of the observed orbit of Uranus. This object was actually Neptune, and this was observed 1 year after And this was, of course, a striking confirmation of Newton's laws, okay? So just after this, still Le Verrier was still looking at the stars and planets, and he started observing Mercury. And he saw that Mercury has a very peculiar orbit. As you might know, Mercury does this preceding orbits around the Sun, okay? And so he said, well, if before also the orbit of Uranus was strange because there was another planet, well, there must be another planet also in this case between Mercury and the Sun that is difficult to observe because if something close to the Sun with normal old, 19th century telescopes, it's difficult to observe. And they said, okay, there is a new planet, unseen planet, that is Vulcan. Okay, we know today that Vulcan doesn't exist, at least in reality, but it exists in the fantasy of Gene Roddenberry, and it's not in the solar system anyway, the Vulcan of Gene Roddenberry. But actually, in 1915, we got the real explanation of these anomalous orbits of Mercury, okay? And this came from the theory of general relativity by Einstein, which explains that since Mercury is so close to the Sun, it really experiences the modification of space-time that is induced by the large mass of the Sun, and this is the reason why it has such strange orbits, okay? So what this example or this analogy can tell us? This is telling us that since the formulation of Newton's gravitational laws, the observation of deviation of celestial objects has been fundamental to expand our understanding of the universe and of the laws that govern the universe, okay? But in one case, the indication of these anomalies was an indication of the presence of something that was similar to what we know, but different, okay? So Neptune. In another case, this was an indication of a still not complete comprehension of what there were the laws of physics underlying the process, okay? So the problem of dark matter is exactly, it's very conceptually similarly to this, okay? And the message also that I want to give is that we must keep an open mind on this problem because we will see that we are exactly in the same situation. We observe a deviation from what we expect from classic gravitational law, and we try to explain this as something else, but we might still be missing something in understanding of gravitation. We'll get a little more in details later. Okay, so let's start discussing which are the observational evidence of dark matter in the universe. Okay, we have observation that spans all the scales from the single galactic scales up to the whole universe. And let me also stress or remind to the younger audience is that the larger scales we explore, the older in time we are looking at, okay? So when we look at the motion of the galaxy rotation curves, actually, what we observe is that, so what we would expect to observe would be like in the solar system, that the motion of the object closer to the center where the mass is concentrated should rotate faster than the one farther away, okay? Because, of course, the gravitation is given by the mass inside this radius. What is observed experimentally is that the velocity is constants between the center and the border of the galaxies, or at least of what we can observe by the galaxies in the sense of what emits electromagnetic radiation. And this can be explained admitting the possibility of the existence of an additional mass that which we cannot see from the electromagnetic point of view, but that is creating this additional gravitational force that is changing the expected velocity of rotation. So here in this formula, you see how the velocity directly depends on the mass of the system. But this is not the only proof. This is actually, again, a historical part. This is what was observed by Vera Rubin in 1970. But even earlier than this, the measurement by Zwicky in 1933, Zwicky was measuring the velocity dispersion of clusters of galaxies, okay? And if we apply the virial theorem, we can correlate the velocity dispersion of galaxies, of the movement of these galaxies, again, with the mass that characterized this system. And again, studying this and comparing this to the observed, if you want, luminosity of the various galaxies from which you could infer the content of the mass, the stars, again, Zwicky demonstrated that the, let's say, the mass that would come out from the use of the virial theorem on the dispersion of velocity and the mass that you would infer just looking at the light of the stars had a factor of two orders of magnitude difference, hundreds of difference, okay? You might think this is not the correct way to weight galaxies or galaxy clusters. We have plenty of them nowadays. Another very interesting and very peculiar effect effect actually of general relativity is what is called the gravitational lensing. Gravitational lensing effect is based on the idea that big masses modify the space-time, and therefore also the path of the light is modified in presence of these large masses. Again, here you have a formula that shows you how much the light is deviated by the presence of a large mass. And again, this depends on the mass. So again, this is a way to measure, if you want, the amount of mass that is present in the galaxies and galaxies cluster. Again, from this measurement, what we observe is that the mass that has gravitational interaction is much, much larger than the mass that has all the other interaction, okay? But we can go even farther, and if we look at the universe as an entire object, and in particular to the cosmic microwave background, which is the imprint inside, let's say, the background of photons of what was the distribution of masses and radiation at the time of the decoupling of photons. So this is just really hundreds of thousands of years after the Big Bang. So what we can observe studying the power spectrum of the variation of the temperature of the cosmic microwave background, which are, let's say, dominated by the interplay, again, by matter that feels gravitational and other forces, and the matter that feels only the gravitational forces, we, again, observe that the universe is mostly composed by a kind of matter that doesn't interact electromagnetically. And this is a show of, this is an example of the power spectrum of the temperature, which is showing you how the different position of the peak and the height of the peak help us measure the amount of dark matter and baryonic matter in the universe. This also happened in the study of large scale structure, which tells us that the big scale structure that we observe nowadays could not have been formed without the addition of something that possesses gravitational interaction, but not the other, okay? So what are all these indications telling us? They're telling us that there is a missing mass problem, okay? Or if you want, that the universe seems to wait much more than what we can observe, okay? But again, let me stress what I said at the beginning. Let's not forget about Vulcan and about the other possible explanation, okay? Because there are also other theories which are trying to explain the current observation by a modification of the Newton dynamics. This is again the example that I gave you at the beginning, because maybe this observation, the fact that this observation doesn't match what we expect, might be due to the fact that we do not still have a complete comprehension of the theory that it is below. Okay, so there is this set of theories that are called the MOND because of modified Newton dynamics, in which you can try to modify either the entire inertia of the Newton's law or just the gravitational force, if you want. And in this way, so you introduce a regime in which the classical, Newton dynamic is valid, another one in which it is not through this additional contrast. In this way, it is possible to explain the rotation curves of the galaxies, but this is like a tautology, because these theories were built in order to do that, but the problem is that they cannot explain as well all the other observations, and in particular, they are very inconsistent in terms of the cosmic microwave background and other observations that we have of the universe. So the question is dark matter a Neptune or a Vulcan? It's like some kind of particles that we haven't observed yet, or it's something missing in our understanding of the universe? I don't know the answer to this question, but I'm an experimentalist and not a theory, so what I will talk to you about from now on is of dark matter as a particle, okay? As a new kind of particle. But again, let me stress, please keep an open mind, because the explanation might be that even a third one, which we have not yet thought about, okay? So from now on, we'll start discussing dark matter as a particle. What's the problem in this discussion? Is that this is a sketch showing you which is, if you want, the candidate Zeus of dark matter, and in the sense that we can expect that we don't have really, we really know nearly nothing of dark matter, in the sense that their masses can span 20 order of magnitudes, and this means that, of course, you can imagine that you cannot use a single experimental technique to test all this possible realization of dark matter, okay? So in this talk, we will talk on the most, we will, let's say, focus on the heaviest kind of dark matter as a particle that we are currently considering in the scientific community, that is the weakly interactive massive particle, okay? Or to say it in another way, and apologies because this is a joke that only Italian people could understand, dark matter può essere ferro o può essere piuma, today dark matter will be ferro, okay? And we will talk about Wimpy Dark Matter. Apologies, I can give you the name of the movie for not Italian people. Okay, getting back to more serious stuff. So the way that we look for dark matter, there are three main complementary ways that if you want, they represent the different way in which you can put the arrow in the Feynman-Grahman above, okay? So what you can look that into is the, if we look from in the arrow from top to bottom, you can look for the annihilation of two dark matter particles into two standard model particles. To do that, you look at the universe, because of course in the universe you have a lot of dark matter, and the idea is that you can look in specific sources where this decay can happen. What's the difficulties in this approach? The difficulties in this approach is that we kind of know the physics in terms of standard model of all these objects that we see in the sky, but not with so much detail. And also the presence of different sources. I mean, there are sources that cannot be identified singularly, or there are phenomena that we do not know completely how to parameterize. So therefore, it means that there are a lot of uncertainties, if you want, in what we expect the emission from classical standard model phenomena in the universe, and therefore it is difficult to find something new and unexpected on top of this. Another way of looking for dark matter is to revert the time of the arrow time, and so looking for two standard model particles that by an interaction will produce two dark matter particles. Of course, to do this, you need to accelerate and to give energy to the two standard model particles enough to be above the threshold for production, and this is typically done at the big accelerator and in particular at the LHC, which is the problem, which is kind of searches. So here, what we are doing, first of all, we are making colliding protons, but the real object colliding are the quarks inside the protons. So proton-proton collider do not allow to pose any kinematic constraint on the initial state because you don't know the real energy of the initial state. So you will produce a lot of stuff together with dark matter, and since dark matter doesn't interact in your detector, it will appear like a missing energy in your detector. But there are other things that appear as missing energy in this kind of experiment, which are neutrinos. So again, it is very difficult to be able to pinpoint the observation of dark matter, especially without making any assumption on the underlying model of dark matter below, because in this case you expect dark matter to be produced together with other particles, but which particle, that is model dependent. So this kind of search is highly model dependent, and again, you do not know what to expect since you don't know anything about dark matter. Finally, last but not least, is the search in which you have the arrow in the, let's say, horizontal, okay? So what you try, you put there something that is made of standard model particle, and you hope to observe a scattering interaction with a dark matter particle. This is what we do in direct searches, and we do it underground, and now I've tell you which are the difficulties in the other two approaches, and I will use the rest of the talk to tell you all the difficulties in the direct direction approach, because of course all of these kind of searches is difficult, none is more or less difficult than the other. Okay, so why we can say that we can put some object here and wait for dark matter to interact with it. So remember what I told you at the beginning, that one of the most striking experimental observation of the presence of dark matter is the rotation curves of the galaxies. Okay, since they are flat, what we expect is that all the galaxies, the spiral galaxies at least, are embedded inside an halo of dark matter. And we believe in a spiral galaxy, that the Milky Way is just like any other classical, more classical galaxies. So also our galaxy is embedded inside this halo of dark matter. And what are we doing around this galaxy? So the galaxy is rotating around the center, around its center, and with the Sun and the other planets, we are rotating together with the Sun around the center of the galaxy. What does this mean? So this means that we are creating a relative motion, a relative velocity between us and this halo of dark matter. And in particular, why I put the Cygnus constellation in this picture? Because the current apparent direction of our motion in the sky is towards the Cygnus constellation. Let me stress again, it's an apparent direction, because in, I don't know, 50 million years we will have turned the galaxy, so we will be pointing to something else. And it's apparent direction again because constellations are not real objects. Again, okay, let me stress, sorry for the people who read the horoscope, but constellation doesn't exist, okay, just to be clear. So what are we doing? We are moving inside this halo of dark matter towards the direction of the Cygnus constellation. So we can see that this can be seen in another way, okay? That it's like, again, it's like when you are on your motorbike and you are driving towards a mountain, you feel the air on your skin, but there is no wind. It's you that you are moving through the air, okay? And again, if you're moving towards the mountain, you see this wind coming from the mountain, but there is no wind coming from the mountain. It's you that are moving towards the mountain, okay? So it's the relative motion of us inside the galaxy with respect to the galactic halo of dark matter that creates this apparent wimp wind that is blowing through our hair in every moment, okay? So this is the reason why we can expect to have some interaction of this WIMP, this dark matter, with our standard model particle. But how can we see something that is not detectable, okay? We play pool with it. I really like this analogy. Because the idea is like that dark matter is like the white ball, which is undetectable. But we'll make the white ball bump against the color ball, and the color ball are detectable. So the goal of the experimentalist is from the movement of this color ball to infer that it was really a white ball that made them move, and then to infer the properties of this white ball. So while in principle, in this assumption that I gave to you up to now, weak interactive massing particle can interact both with atoms and nuclei. And more recently, there has been an opening, into interaction through scattering to nuclei, because we have lowered, if you want, the region of search of dark matter in terms of masses, and therefore order MeV or tens, hundreds of MeV dark matter couple better to electrons than nuclei. Again, for the sake of simplicity and also of time, I will focus from now on for the classical WIMPs that, scatters against nuclei. So, which are the problem in this game? First of all, the kinematic of the problem. So you have to imagine that, the target nucleus is still in the laboratory frame. The dark matter moves, the relative motion between us and the dark matter is more or less 220 kilometers per second. And even if 220 kilometers per second seems to you a very high velocity, in terms of particle, it's very low, because this is a non-relativistic velocity. And this means that we have a non-relativistic interaction. So again, this is really, again, very, very similar to playing pool, because this particle and the atoms will move like balls in the pool, okay? What does this mean? This implies also that a parameter of high importance is the reduced mass between the dark matter particle and your target nuclei, okay? So it is easy to understand. Given the same dark matter mass, an helium nuclei that is much lighter, for example, than a xenon nuclei, will receive and will have a much larger energy that are very, very heavy nuclei, okay? Because, in, again, as you can see from this formula, and this is, again, really physics 101, see? The recoiling energy depends directly, of course, yes, on an angle, but on the reduced mass of the system, okay? So this is telling you that also, depending on which kind of region of the dark matter with masses you want to explore, you need to optimize your target choice, because the largest sensitivity of an experiment is at the dark matter mass equal to the target mass, because that is the point in which there is the largest exchange of momentum, and therefore the point in which you have largest access to the dark matter, if you want. But this is not the end of the story, so it's difficult because it's low energy. We are talking about order kV energy. And it's difficult because the expected rate is super, super low. Okay, so from some arguments that come from the freeze-out, meaning, let's say, what happened between the moment in which dark matter was coupled to all the other particles in the universe, and after that the universe expanded enough and the dark matter stopped interacting and left us with the current and the today Rayleigh density. So today Rayleigh density can be parameterized in terms of this freeze-out mechanism, and without entering too much into detail, we end up with, let's say, the cross-section of a WIMP-like dark matter, so a dark matter of the order of GV, to be at least of 10 to the minus 38 or even lower, in the sense that this must be a weak scale interaction. And again, to just put some number and to have some idea, we are talking about less than one event per year per kilos, okay? What's the problem? Is that there are so many other objects or common particles that can mimic a dark matter interaction, and that we are really overwhelmed by this kind of background, and we don't even realize that. Because first of all, okay, the most classical one, the easy one, are cosmic rays. We know that every moment we are transpassed by cosmic rays coming from the universe, mainly muons and neutrinos. But this is not, again, the end of the story, because even the food that we eat as radioactive contaminants, with, let me stress, do not come from atomic bomb experiment or whatever. These are the natural radioactivity contamination that is in the food. For example, in banana you have potassium. Potassium has a high, let's say, concentration of its isotope, that is potassium 40, that decays radioactively. So, but this is normal radioactivity, okay? Similarly, the floor on which we walk is radioactive. Rome is one of the most radioactive cities because it's full of tufo and this kind and calcium and this kind of things. But even going farther, the air that you are breathing contains radioactivity, typically in the form of radon, which is a very volatile gas, and which decays. So looking for dark matter, and each of these, given also the number that you see on these slides, have a much more higher probability of happening than any possible interaction with dark matter, okay? So it's really like looking for a needle in a haystack, okay? And we have several ways to reduce this haystack. So first of all, the easiest thing to do, not really logistically, but still, is to protect yourself from cosmic rays, okay? This is just like when it's raining and you go below some cover to not have the rain hit on you. Okay, similarly, we go under the mountain or inside mines below the ground, hundreds, actually thousands of meters, because rocks can protect us from this cosmic ray. But then what's the problem? The rocks that surround us underground, they contain radioactivity. And this is an example of the radioactivity of different laboratories in terms of gamma and neutron, okay? And we see that the rate is still not so low. So what you can do? You can further shield your detector once you are underground with additional shielding that can be passive, just to stop stuff if you want. So typically you use high Z material to stop gammas and something with a large amount of hydrogen to stop neutrons, so water or polyethylene, and for the gamma typically lead or copper. But then at that point, your shield is made of some material that by its own will create radioactivity. And so what do? At that point you work very hard and you try to select the less possible radioactive material. And this is an example that this is kind of well known, that we use ancient Roman lead that was that was fished, let's say, from the bottom of the Mediterranean in the late 2000s. And since this lead was produced 2000 years ago, all the internal radioactivity of the lead already decayed, and so this lead can be considered pure. But if you produce lead today, that will be radioactive, okay? So there is an ice stack that is not reducible, and this is also one of the reasons, if you want, for which all the development of directional dark matter started, that is the neutrinos. So this is a sketch of the flux of neutrinos arriving on Earth, when you see that the highest flux come from the Sun and then continuing atmospheric diffuse supernovae and atmospheric, and below you see how the rate of the recoils, of nuclear recoils as a function of energy would appear from interaction from this neutrino. What is the point? Is that neutrino can interact with a coherent scattering with your nuclei, so just very similarly to, let's see, if you want, how dark matter would do, and therefore would create inside your detector a signal which looks identically and exactly identical to a dark matter signal, okay? And this is where the infamous neutrino floor was born, if you have ever read about it. Actually, today we slightly changed the perspective on this concept. So before we called this neutrino floor in the sense that it was an unsurpassable limit at which experiment should just shut down and that was the end. It's not the case anymore. We now define it in another way, but the message is still the same. But let me stress this because this is something new, but it's something that is already, let's say, widely accepted in the community. So the idea is that you can describe your discovery limit as a function of the observed number of the December neutrino background events and the uncertainties on your neutrino fluxes, okay? You can think about three different regimes, one in which you are background free, when you start seeing some events, but you can still work with Poissonian subtraction, and when you are purely dominated by the systematics. And starting from this, you can define a parameter n, if you want, that is the gradient of the discovery limit, okay? And the idea is that n is equal to 2 up to normal, for normal Poissonian subtraction, and is larger than 2 when the systematic starts to dominate, okay? And this n factor is plotted in this plot. Anyway, the bottom line, the takeaway message of this plot is that in order to reduce or improve, if you want, reduce in terms of going down, maybe the better word is improve. In order to improve the sensitivity of an experiment of a factor x, it requires an increase of exposure of a factor x to n, okay? So this is telling you that until n is less than 2, it is still doable. When n gets bigger than 2, it's not doable, because if you want to improve of a factor 10 the sensitivity of an experiment and you have to make an experiment 100 times larger, you don't have space in Gran Sasso Lab, so that's all. And this is a plot that is showing you at which, so which is, let's say, the exposure in Tonnier required to an experiment to reach this systematically dominated limit. And you see that while for high masses you can go up to 10 to the 2 and 10 to the 3 tons, for low masses already at 100 kilo, you start to be systematically dominated by this. So this is a big problem. So in the end, this becomes a fog and not a floor, so it's not unsurpassable, but there is not enough money and enough space underground in the world to surpass it. So in the end, if you want, the message is still the same. This approach is more correct because each other approach shown before was dependent on the experiment and on the different, let's say, performance of the experiment. This approach is interesting because it's experiment independent, and that's why it's interesting to look at this in this way. So what you end up with, you have an experiment in which you try to protect your detector by the interaction, but at the end you will have some signal and a lot, actually, you will not have signal for sure, but you will have a lot of background in your experiment. So you need to find other way to discriminate your signal from your background. And what you can do, there are two kinds of background, okay? You have electromagnetic background that is given by gamma and electrons, and in order to reject this, you can exploit the material response, and you have natural background like neutrons and neutrinos, and these behave exactly like dark matter, and therefore in order to discriminate against this you need to use some feature of the expected signal rate. Okay, for what concern the material response, you might remember from your studies in the first years of physics is that any interaction of radiation with matter will release energy into the matter in three forms, in three channels, okay? That is heat through photon, scintillation light through photons, and the ionization through charge, okay? And different particle at different energy we release with a different proportion into these three channels. Again, to visualize this in a more clear way, this is an example. So a nuclear recoil and an electron recoil at the same energy will partition their energy deposition in a different way. So if an experiment can measure at least two out of three of these channels, you can compare how an electron recoil or a nuclear recoil will appear in the combination of these two signals, and you can actively discriminate them. And this is the concept on which all the experiments of dark matter are based, okay? So the scheme before is reproduced here, where different experimental techniques are put either in the corner, if they are sensitive only to one of these, partition of the energy, or in between, if they are sensitive to two of them, and therefore they can do particle discrimination with them. So this is okay if you want to discriminate electron recoil from nuclear recoil. But what can you do if you want to discriminate nuclear recoil from other nuclear recoil? It's very difficult, you don't have really a choice, okay? So what's the message that I'm trying to give to you? Is that in general, dark matter is a search that has been hampered by many false promises, which maybe the youngest of you don't know or don't remember, and I will list it here. But the point is that many things can look like dark matter if you don't know when they're coming, where they're coming from, and this where as a reason for this, okay? So we all know and remember the claim by Dama of the annual modulation, which, if you remember, in the same year was followed by several claims by Cogent, CREST, and CDMS in the same masses. Then they found it was background. But at that time, it seems that we found dark matter. Then we had, more recently, there was an excess in the electron recoil, in the electron recoil rate for xenon 1 ton, which again, the subsequent year was demonstrated to be background. Then we have, even again more recently, all the detectors that are being developed in the bolometric approach, so detectors at very low temperature that measure mainly the heat, but a lot of detectors, these are based on silicon detector, based on CCD detector, based on gas. A lot of detectors are observing an unexplained low energy excess appearing in different detectors in a way that cannot be explained by dark matter. In fact, there exists a new kind of collaboration that is called XSS, that is, involving all these different experiments to try to understand why they have this excess. But this is an experimental problem, okay? And the problem regarding these searches is that if they don't find a solution, this could also be the end of the bolometric approach, because this, it seems that it's related to the way that the sensors are attached, and so that the movement or the stress of the sensor can cause this strange appearance of the signal. And then we already said the neutrinos. Neutrinos, there is nothing that you can do with it unless you work in the field that I am trying to develop, that is directional dark matter, okay? So the answer to this is to try to exploit the direction of the signal, okay? Why the direction of the signal? Now we talk about which are the features of the signal from dark matter. So we said, we discussed before that we live in this hall of dark matter, we move through it, and so from the kinematic, the expected spectrum for an interaction of dark matter is like this. It's a falling exponential. It doesn't have any peculiar feature like the Higgs in gamma that you see in LHC, that is a clear peak on top of the background. Here, the signal is a falling exponential, and the background is a falling exponential, and therefore to observe a falling exponential on top of a falling exponential, it's very, very difficult. You have to have a control of your background unprecedented to be able to do this, and this is what most of the experiments do, okay? Then you can try to exploit another dependence, that is the annual dependence, okay, or the temporal dependence. Where does this come from? So we're talked up to now about the sun moving around in the galaxy, but the Earth moves around the sun, okay? So what does this mean? So that half of the year, the velocity of the Earth is summed to the one of the sun, and half of the year is subtracted. So if you look at the overall rate of your signal, you would expect an annual modulation of this kind. What's the problem in this annual modulation? That as you can imagine, since it's connected to the season, you can imagine a lot of background that might be able to modulate with season. Nonetheless, up to now, nobody has found yet the explanation for this observation, that is the famous Damam observation, which observed exactly this annual modulation. Okay? But the position in the parameter space in which Damam observed this was excluded by other experiments. So this is very puzzling. This is a problem for the community. We don't have an explanation for this, okay? So what's the possible final solution? It is to exploit the direction, okay? The direction is given by the fact that the Earth rotates around itself, okay? And as we said at the beginning, Cygnus is a constellation. We are pointing towards Cygnus, but if you think about the other constellation, Libra, Taurus, whatever, you know that they move around the sky during the day, and so does Cygnus. So this means that every second, the direction from which you expect a dark matter interaction changes. Okay, and this fact cannot be mimicked by any background, okay? If you translate this in galactic coordinate, you have an asymmetry that is of order one between left or right. So dark matter, the direction is the only way to positively identify a dark matter signal, because only a dark matter signal can have this distribution in the sky, because direction allows you to correlate with the galactic origin of the dark matter, which is the thing that only direction can do. And also you expect the background to be much different. Actually, what you see there is a real, these are real data from an experiment that is called New Age also. Okay, so this means also that you can tolerate background, even unknown and even neutral background, because the neutral background will never be on the same direction of dark matter. This implies also that you can play with neutrino. Neutrino doesn't become a limit. There is not a limit, but it's an opportunity. Because since you can reject, not only reject neutrino exploiting the direction, but you can identify neutrino through the direction, because the sun never superimposes to the signals during the year. So not only you can discriminate against neutrino, you can promote them to a physics case, which is what we are also doing. And last but not least, with the direction information, you can really perform, you can probe the dark matter nature, and you can perform dark matter astronomy in the sense that you can have a much, much better constraint of dark matter problem with a single measurement with direction. This is understandable. Direction gives you more information, okay? So, which is the problem? How can you do a directional experiment? I mean, it's clear that we are talking about very low energies. We want to see the distance of track that are very, 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 very small. So, but at the same time, the lower density that we employ, the less sensitivity that we have to dark matter. That's why I call this eternal struggle, okay? And different experiments, different collaboration are trying to give a different solution to this problem, if you want. So either exploiting gas, like in the top, or liquid or solid. But what can be shown is that directionality really, only in gas and in low density gas can be really preserved at the energy of interest of dark matter, okay? This is an example of recoils of the orders of tens of keV from left to right, first in solid emulsion and then in low pressure TPC. You see that the dimensions at play are completely different. Not only they're completely different in the sense that it's easier to see a recoil direction in the gas, but also that the intrinsic struggling and multiple scattering of the inside the matter makes really impossible to really identify the original direction in something that is so dense as crystals or as emulsion. And so this is the way that we are going, not only my experiment, but there is a community in this. So to use a time projection chamber with gas, not liquid, because time projection chamber are inherently three-dimensional detector, and given the proper, if you want, segmentation at the anode and the time sampling, they can be up to 3D, okay, full 3D detector, which have particle ID by comparing by studying the day over the X, because since you have granularity, you can study the energy deposit as a function of the day over the X, and this allows you to identify particle, and you can also identify the vector sense and the angle, okay? Of course, depending on how much, if you want, you invest on the kind of the readout. This is a very big scheme and overview of the current existing project in this field, among which there is also Cygnus. It's just to show you that we're really trying a lot of different technologies and different gases. And that most of us, except from the French people, all of us got together to develop Cygnus, which is the future possible tone-scale detector starting from the development of this other experiment. So finally, I will talk to you about our experiment in these last 5 minutes, and I hope I can manage too. So this is an experiment that came from the merging of my ERC conservator grant with the funding from INFN for the Cygnus experiment. Now we are about 60 members in international collaboration. You see all the institutions that are work with us. So the approach of Cygnus is the following. We use a triple gem amplification stage with an helium CF4 gas mixture. The choice of the mixture is done because in order to obtain not only charge amplification, but scintillation of the light. So together with the amplification of charge, we produce light. And then we look at this light by a photomultiplier that gives us the information in the direct along the drift direction, but the innovative approach is to couple this to CMOS camera. CMOS camera are the same that we have in our cell phone, okay? So this also means that the development of this object is very fast, and is very fast outside of the scientific context, and is funded much more than we could ever be funded. And with this CMOS camera, you can really have clear images of the track, okay? Which I'll show you even better later. And together, putting together these two information, you can really reconstruct track in 3D, and the goal of my ERC was to develop negative ion drift, which I hope I will get to that at the end, or you can ask me at the question, to operate with negative ion drift this technology. I hope I can tell you why. But first, let me show you this. So these are images of the tracks taken by our detector, and let me stress that these are not analyzed images. These are raw images. This is what I see every day when I'm in the lab and we take data, and I see continuously this image in which you can really play, oh, that's a proton, that's a muon, that's an electron. I think it's especially for the educative purposes, very cool, and you happen also sometimes to have surfer, just by chance, okay? So, okay, these are some features of the optical approach, which I will skip because I don't have much time. And this is the timeline of our experiment with some of the papers that we've published. So we are in between at the end of phase zero, in which we developed several prototypes and put one underground, that is LIME, is the biggest one, is 50 liter, is to demonstrate our technology underground. And we are building the Cygnus 04, which is a 0.4 cubic meter detector that will be serve as demonstrator effectively of the technology. So this is a picture of LIME. LIME is 33 by 33 centimeters square times 50 centimeters of drift distance for 50 liter total volume. These are things that show that, the overground commissioning, but what was even more interesting are these data that you can find on the paper recently published on our PhysicsJ. When we did the calibration for electron recoil, you see very nicely how increase the energy of the electron recoil. You start to see the real shape of them. At very low energy, this is dominated by diffusion, and that's why you see just a dot. And you see that we achieve a very good linearity of the response of the detector between 3.7 and 37 keV. We also partially demonstrated the capability for discriminating nuclear recoil and electron recoil at the level of 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 3, with a very simplistic approach that cut on a single variable. And now one of my PhD students is developing machine learning approach to this, in which it seems that we can reach 10 to the 3 background rejection between 1 and 40 GV, which is really impressive. And this is the underground location of LIME. LIME is here now. This is underground Gran Sasso, and incidentally, this is exactly in front of Dama. Okay, so if there is dark matter, we're going to find it. And we plan a staged approach to Cygnus, to LIME, in the sense that we will increase the shielding. And this is the scheme, so starting unshielded, then with 2 levels of copper shielding, and then one also with water. We did a full simulation of the background expected with LIME, which was also transformed into CMOS images through a digitization algorithm that we have. And these are the very, very preliminary results of the latest run underground, which shows you first LIME unshielded, LIME shielded. It shows you which is the typical occupancy in the 2 cases. So you see clearly that once you shield the detector, you lower the intrinsic radioactivity. And on the right, very, very preliminary from today, from this morning, from my student, these are the comparison of the data in Monte Carlo. So you see there are still something that needs to be improved in terms of normalization. But I myself was very surprised that it was so good conclude the agreement at the first, let's say, at the first look. And this is a first look on our capability underground of identifying nuclear recoil. So what is shown here is, I would say, more or less the length of the track versus the typical energy deposit. And you see that adding a neutron source that induces nuclear recoil, there is an appearance of this nuclear recoil band, which is clearly separated by the electron band down to really few keV. This is about 10 keV or even less. Again, this is just an example. It doesn't represent our capability of discrimination. It's just one plot that we just started. These data were taken at the end in August. So just for you to be clear. And these are the prospects for the future of Cigno. So Cigno 04, this is our location inside OLEF, which you don't know because nobody knows that it exists. OLEF is a small hole connecting all A and all B. And we will try to fit into the hole like a Cigno in a bottle. And actually, we are starting the infrastructure work now at the end of the year or beginning of January. And the detector will be finished by next year. And if this will be successful, and if NFN will be good with us, what the final plan is, all of this was to demonstrate the capability of the experimental approach and our capability of managing this as a low radioactive detector underground. So if this is going to work, the future will be Cigno 30 cubic meter. 30 cubic meter is a dimension at which Cigno can significantly contribute in terms of exploring uncharted territories of the current parameter space. And what I would like again to stress, and it's very interesting of Cigno, is that our gas mixture, that is helium CF4, possesses the fluorine, which being a spin god makes Cigno sensitive to both spin independent and spin dependent couplings. And given the lightness of helium and also the relative lightness of fluorine, we are sensitive to both couplings below 10 GeV, which is something very impressive in the sense that we are really able to explore the low mass region in both the couplings with a single experiment. And these are prospects for the expected limit in different background scenario. So I arrived here, which is the latest topic, and I might be out of time. You need to tell me if you want me to tell you about this part. So a small spoiler about this part. What I'm going to show to you is something that we plan to submit to Nature. And also for this, when I will arrive at the plot, I will have to ask YouTube to stop the showing of the slide. So you can tell me if you have had enough at this point, or if you want to see these very innovative findings that we have recently accomplished.
Elisabetta, let me make a suggestion. We yes. make a short round of questions and comments up to now, and then you give us the last.
I think it's okay? Allora, but before that, again, no, just the conclusion that it's independent of this. So this I will skip very fast. You're not seeing anything. And so, okay, no, another conclusion is this, that actually you have really thousands of possible application of high precision imaging TPC. And today I discussed only directional dark matter, but these are a lot. There is a paper on this. It's one of the SNOMAS paper that tells you all the possible physics cases that you can achieve with this technology. And actually, I am working on four of these currently, and three of them are funded with dedicated funding that I got from Prince and Fare. And unfortunately, I did not have time to talk about you today about this other project, but of course, I will be happy if in the future you are curious, or also later if you are curious. I have other slides. So my conclusion is this. I hope I convinced you that there is only one future for dark matter, okay? So either dark matter is observed, low mass, high mass, you will need a directional experiment to characterize dark matter and to prove incontrovertibly that that's a dark matter signal. Second option, you have incompatible results, which incidentally is already today because DAMA put a constraint there and we have limit below. Again, only a directional experiment can confirm the galactic origin of the observed signal, or we reach the neutrino floor. Therefore, in order to go on, again, only a directional experiment can go beyond the neutrino floor. So while today is still a new and a young technology, I believe that directional dark matter search is the future of dark matter. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this broad and intense overview. I think we have a lot of material to discuss, but then I'm curious for your last piece. Okay, so questions, comments, curiosities.
Okay, I can start. So thank you very much for a very nice colloquium. Can you go back really fast? Yes. to the slide with the projections. Yes. Where is Dhamma in this plot? Oh, yes.
Dhamma, it's light green. Okay, in Dhamma you see only in the spin dependent. There is a tiny, no, it's also in the spin independent. It's very, very light. Let's see if you see my cursor. This is Dhamma. Dhamma sodium and Dhamma iodine.
I was asking for the best fit region that I think are the ones on the left. So you will be able to.
So actually, probably with Cigno 04, we should be able to go below Dhamma. This is not something that we advertise because it's not something that INFN wants
you,
to
so, okay.
But once we get below Dhamma and we publish the limit with directionality below Dhamma, then we but Cigno 04 should be enough to go below Dhamma. Yes, for spin independent, I'm not sure, but for spin independent, I'm pretty sure, yes. For spin independent, yes. And incidentally, in the detector setup that we have in front of Dhamma, we eventually plan to do a seasonal measurement of the neutron flux.
Maybe for the youngest part of the audience, what is about Dhamma? Dhamma was a claim which is already several decades old. And it required a lot of experimental development in order to be able to develop detectors that have the large size large enough to be able to confirm with a completely independent technique whether the signal is there or not. So this is something which is there since how many years?
So Dhamma is born in 1989, Dhamma, and I think the first claim is 2002.
So you can understand that this is really a very key question in the field. Okay, more questions or comments?
I was just wondering about the theory of dark matter particles. So, with these experiments that you're working with, do you have any theory on the properties of these particles, or do we just imagine that like they will interact in some way with actual matter?
Thank you for the question. So, what we know about dark matter, again, from the experimental observation of the universe, for example, we know that it must be neutral, because otherwise we would see charge interaction. It must be stable, in the sense that at least the age of the universe, or more or less. So this, for example, would imply that either it has a phase space for decay that is very small, so it's very light, or there is some symmetry that prevents the decay of dark matter, for example. We know that whatever mechanism, let's say, produced or and eventually, let's say, give us the current amount of dark matter must be consistent with what we observe today as the relic density, that is this 27-26%, depending on the experiment. What do we know else? We know that it must be weakly interacting, again, because otherwise we would have seen observation. So we know all of this. If you want, you can realize all of this in so many ways, which was the ferro and puma, I think. Yes, so you can realize this, you see, which are, I mean, there are really like 40 order of magnitude, something like this. So if you want, the experiments are built in order to focus on a class of particle, okay? So we focus on the WIMP. Again, we hope the WIMP to interact, because dark matter, as the one that we observe, and also the one that we search, could maybe interact only gravitationally, and at that point we are lost. There is no way for direct detection. So there is nothing, there is no proof that make us say that dark matter interacts also with something else apart from gravity. This is our very, very wishful thinking from our side. Okay, from the rest, we don't know nothing. So we just know that the dark matter properties must respect this big requirement, if you want, that come from the observation of the universe. I hope I answer your question.
Thank you. My question is collected to his from this point of view. So mainly at the beginning of the presentation, the motivations behind the existence of dark matter were connected to a macroscopic and universal scale. But beyond the experiments that you have described, are there any other experiments on a quantum level that seem to suggest an interaction with dark matter particles, or that certain quantum behavior may be caused by dark matter?
What exactly do you mean with the quantum level, just to understand?
On a microscopic, just particle scale. I'm sorry if I'm not specific.
You mean like at the level in terms of particle physics?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for the question. This is also a very interesting question. I didn't have time to discuss this, but why some of these candidates are particularly interested for dark matter search? Because weakly interactive, so there are two open problems in the standard model, okay? One is the renormalizability of the X mass, okay? So we know that unless you apply some fine tunings, the X mass would go to infinite because of the correction in the loop, okay? So this is the reason why SUSY supersymmetry was invented, if you want, so that you can add the supersymmetric partners that will cancel the divergence inside the loop. The SUSY is not exact, so the cancellation is not equal to zero, and you have some correction that still make the correction finite. Okay, so in this sense, we like weakly interactive massive particle as candidate because they simultaneously solve the problem of the standard model and the dark matter problem. Similarly, that's the similar reason why we look for axions, which of course I could not have time to cover. Another brick problem on the standard model is the strong CP. So if you write the Lagrangian of the QCD and you put all the allowed terms in that, you end up with a theta violating term, which would induce a momentum in the neutron. So since we don't have observation of this, we have limit at the level of I don't remember on the electromagnetic momentum of the neutron, but I remember the limit on theta. So this coupling, we have limited, it needs to be less than 10 to the minus 10. And there is no reason for this. So typically in physics, a coupling is either one or is zero. And it's zero because a symmetry is protecting the quantity to be different from zero. When a quantity is very tiny, typically it means that you have a symmetry that is slightly breaked, and that's why you have, let's say, this term. So a solution of the strong CP problem is the Peccei-Quinn mechanism, in which Peccei and Quinn hypothesized the existence of an additional, they promoted this theta term to a dynamic field, which is the axions, and the axion in the moment that it acquires the vacuum expectation value slightly breaks this symmetry, okay, creating the axions emerges like the Goldstone boson of the theory, okay, and so again, the reason why we look for axions is that the axions are nice because they can solve simultaneously the problem, one of the problem of the standard model, together with the problem of dark matter. So this is the connection between other models. But let me stress also another thing, that I believe that this requirement that we imposed on dark matter, in the sense, WIMP must also solve the standard model problems, or axions must solve the strong CP problems. This is something that we convince ourselves that needed to be so. There is no reason why dark matter must solve all the problems in the world, okay? And also bring peace. Okay, so I think that also in this sense we should make like a step behind, in the sense that you can look for dark matter doesn't necessarily need to solve all the problems. So you can have a WIMP like dark matter that doesn't solve the problem of the mass of the Higgs, and an axion like dark matter. In fact, you have axions and axion like particles that solves only the dark matter problem and not the strong CP problem.
Okay, you have another question.
Hi, thank you for the speech. I just wanted to ask, in the field of high energy particle physics, if a muon collider could help us in finding dark matter, because in proton-proton collisions we have a lot of stuff, while muons are elementary particles, so I wonder if it could help us. Thank you.
I'm thinking again. You're asking me all theoretical questions, and I'm an experimentalist, so I'm trying hard. But and you have all these theoreticians so much renowned in front of you that I'm afraid to say stupid things in front of them. But I don't. So you should assume an explicit coupling of dark matter with leptons, which I'm not sure that if you can assume. You, I mean, if we expect dark matter to directly couple with leptons. I mean, yes. The search that we do on direct dark matter with the possibility of having an electron recoil is that you would have them scattering through electron scatter. So it's not a coupling in terms of fields, okay? So in this sense, I cannot imagine like a muon collider in which you can produce, because you should produce this through some loop. I don't think it's possible. Maybe some strange kind of dark matter, but not the classical one. Ha detto giusto.
Okay, the discussion goes on.
Yeah, I'm happy. So you are testing my knowledge of theoretical physics, I understand.
Hello, I wanted to ask a more practical question.
Okay, thank you.
So this should be easier for you. You said that the time trajectory chambers can at least try to detect the WIMPs, but if you don't know if dark matter can interact with the electromagnetic forces, you know that it can't interact with the electromagnetic forces, and you don't know if it can interact with weak forces, how can you expect it to ionize some atoms?
Thanks for the question, because the point is that, let's see if it's in the sketch. So as I said, you cannot look for dark matter. I think I can draw it. It's even easier. Okay, the idea is this. So if this is the tracks that is creating the ionization, the idea is that dark matter arrives, it bumps against an atoms, the atom, and the ionized atoms gives you your signal. So you see the effect of the scattering of dark matter in your detector. Okay, like with the game of pool, grazie. When we were saying the game of pool, so we measure, so the ionization signal is given by the color ball. Okay, it's the color ball that we can see. And they ionize the gas because they are common matter. And then from the, so what is very difficult is to be sure that those atoms did not move because of some standard model interaction. And then from that to reconstruct the properties and the identity of the dark matter. So does this explain your, answer your question?
No. So the dark matter particles should physically move these particles that are going to ionize others?
Exactly. Again, it's like really like a pool, because, I mean, for the particles, the velocity are very low, like pool. So you will have really the, and also in this sense, you will have the, so the scattering, the interaction that we expect is that you have your WIMP, and then your WIMP will go like this, and this will be your nuclei, okay? So this is the kind of interaction that you expect, really simple scattering.
I think on a similar note to this, I see that now all detectors are underground to protect from like other radiation, like cosmic radiation.
Yes.
So could we not imagine that perhaps dark matter is not absorbed by the atmosphere?
Good question. More recently, people have started to look for strongly interacted dark matter. And you can make limits of this, put in detector overground, of course. And you can also play with this in other things. Is that the strongly interacting dark matter is a little on the border of all the parameters of space available for what it could be dark matter. Let me say in another way. Since we are not finding dark matter, we are scratching the bottom of the barrel. Okay. Yes. So it could be, but it's not. I mean, it's a very complex realization to have a strongly attracted dark matter that can also fulfill all the requirement from the observation in the universe.
Oh, I see. So if it interacted more, it would just mean that we would have found about it sooner.
Or we would see other effect in the object, in the celestial object. Again, this, you have other professor much more prepared than me to tell you.
I don't see other raised hands, but I have a naive curiosity.
Of course, of course.
So you mentioned about, so the motivation for directional detectors is to look for astrophysical objects, so astronomy with dark matter.
Yes.
But the range of energies can also be mimicked again by neutrino interactions, and we do have a lot of astrophysical models. So I guess to discriminate then, in case of a positive detection that we are looking forward to, from, let's say, more conventional astrophysical scenarios, possibly the energy spectrum counts. So the question is statistics. What is the time scale for reaching this goal?
So first of all, who knows where dark matter is? So who knows how much big detector we need to make? Now the argument is maybe I did not. So what I meant with dark matter astronomy is that we can characterize the distribution of the halo in this galaxy. We cannot make other dark matter astronomy. So I apologize if this was a little misleading in this sense. And the idea is that now I don't remember the number, but on this. There is the famous paper which is the experimental reach of directional dark matter, where there is this plot. Now I don't remember which are the assumptions exactly behind this plot, but this for example gives you a comparison of the reach. On the top, with a single measurement, what you can understand, which we measure energy only, or also together with direction. Because if you want, when you measure with the direction, you can constrain the velocity distribution, and therefore in this sense you have more information. And after this, with a larger scale, I would say hundreds of events you can really characterize. So if you want, dark matter astronomy is the step beyond 1 ton. It's 10 ton. It's G7, I don't know, because currently the directional dark matter detector are the scale of 1 cubic meter, and 1 cubic meter is 1 kilo in gas. So,
okay.
We try.
So there is one last comment, and then we look forward. Okay. We go directly to the last phase of your.
Okay, that is
seminar.
Very. It's very experimental part. The last part.
Thank you. I would like to ask about like the experimental setup, and maybe I can phrase the question as why now is the moment to look at this directionality. Dark matter searches. Is it related to new technologies, or is it related to just new?
It's technology, or if you want, whenever you look for something new, you first go with the easiest stuff. Okay, so this doesn't. I'm not saying that the other technologies that have been developed are easy, but I'm talking about really numbers. So you have to think that. So it's already difficult to measure the deposition of the energy of the order of keV. In a detector. So just to know that there was an event or there was not, it's difficult. To measure its energy is more difficult. And to measure the track, so in order to measure the direction, you need to be sensitive, not just to the track with enough granularity to see the dimension, to the direction. This is extremely challenging from the point of view of the technology. Because again, just to give you numbers, these tracks will be long nanometer in solid, micrometer in liquid, and millimeter, not really, hundreds of microns in gas. So this is the problem, this is the technology. And only only recently, especially TPC, have reached this level of granularity in which you can really sample, if you want, hundreds of micron tracks. This is also thanks to micropattern gas detector development, and also the development of improved readout. What we use is this optical readout with the camera. You can also use highly pixelated detector. Again, it's all a technological advancement in general of the CMOS process, which ends up both in camera and in pixel detector. So yes. Technology.
Okay, so the stage is yours.
Okay, thank you. And now we only camera, perfect. Okay, so let me get back that. Now, I really care about presenting you this because this is the topic on which I based my entire career, is the topic on which I got the individual fellowship, and is the topic for which I got the ERC Consolidator. And it's a topic, that, so the ERC Consolidator, and it's a topic that we manage to demonstrate, and that's what, which at the beginning, I mean, when you write the ERC, you're not really sure if you are going to make it, okay? So typically, you're very optimistic. So that's why I really care about this. So one thing that we didn't maybe discuss, and for this I will make a drawing, is the following. So what is the problem in a time projection chamber? Okay, let's say you have the time projection chamber like this. Let's make a square section, okay? So imagine that you have your original track that is produced at this point, okay? In order to detect the track, you need to drift your primary ionization charges to your amplification plane, okay? What happens, so this is a drawback of every gaseous detector that you can imagine, is that the primary charges, while drifting to the amplification plane, they suffer multiple scattering because they are in the gas, they suffer multiple scattering, and so they diffuse, okay? So again keeping the analogy of the optics, is like, I mean, the original track is this, the original track, but then what arrives at your amplification plane is this. Okay, so you understand by yourself that this is an issue when you want to detect the direction of a very, very short particle, okay? Because imagine that, now I've made it big, imagine this short particle is like this, so if I have this precision in tracking, I can still see the direction. If I have this precision, what do I see? Nothing, okay? So this is an open issue, okay, of course, to make this kind of detector. So classical time projection chamber and all gas detector, what do they use? So when you have your track, your initial track, you ionize the gas in the sense that you have, now for sake of simplicity, I will put all the ions on one side and all the electrons on the other side. While it's not like this, of course. So you ionize the gas, so you produce electron and an ion pair, and you drift the electron to the amplification plane. So these poor electrons, while they're drifting to the amplification plane, also they enter into a pool game also, because you have the electron that is like this, that is drifting in the gas, and then you have the gas molecules, and this is out of scale, this is really a lot of scale in the sense that the gas molecules are much, much, much bigger than the electron in this sense. So you can imagine that an electron scattering, I mean, a small ball scattering on a big ball, what will do? Will make a very diffuse, so it will change the direction a lot, okay? So this is a problem, of course, electron will diffuse. So which is the game-changing approach behind the negative ion drift. The game-changing approach is the following. You put inside your, okay, this is drawn already. So you put inside your detector a highly negative, electronegative dopant, another gas. You just need just a little salt of it. You don't need very much of it, okay? 1% is enough. So what happens? If you have this very electronegative gas, the moment that the primary electron ionized, okay, they are captured by this other molecule. So imagine you have the primary electron and you have these molecules that are very high electronegative affinity, in the sense that they like to take an electron. So these electrons are captured at very short distances from the origin of production by these ions, which become negative ions, and since they are negative and you have an applied electric field, now instead of the electron you will have these big ions drifting towards the amplification stage. And since now, instead of having this against this, you have this against this, okay, there is a good match in the kinematic of the of what's traveling and what are the gas molecule. So the charge that is traveling, that is still negative, is just bigger if you want, thermalized during drift, okay? And this has been demonstrated a lot of time that you can reach the thermal limit, okay? The thermal limit is the limit in which you can actually describe the diffusion, the width of a cloud charge after having drifted the time t inside a gas in this way, where this is the diffusion coefficient, and this relation, so this is sigma square, and this relation ends up to be 2 kTL this, where K is the Boltzmann constant, T is the temperature of the gas, L is the length traversed, E is the electric charge, and E is the electric field, okay? Because in the end, you can rewrite this as, let me see if I remember the exact number. I think it's like this now, forget about the other terms. So the idea is that the diffusion is proportional to the energy of the characteristic energy of the drifting particle, okay? So the lowest possible limit for diffusion, no, is when the particle has thermal energy, and you end up that epsilon is equal to the third kT, and you end up with this formula. I think that this is clear, no? And it's also clear that the lowest possible energy that a particle can have is the thermal energy, no? A particle cannot be lower than the thermal energy. Okay, this is the premises. So this is something, so the possibility to exploit this feature to strongly reduce the diffusion is known since the 2000. It's about 20 years that people are trying to do this. And this is a sketch of the work that has been done, both in terms of charge readout and optical readout at low pressure or high pressure. So this talk is the only, so us, we are the only one who work with optical readout at atmospheric pressure. And there is only another work on optical readout which is not even published, was a talk, okay? So this is by itself, if we want, is innovative. But what is more innovative? This is the setup with which we realized this measurement. Is a realization is small of this slime detector. Again, if you want, I can give you all the details of this, and also what we are doing. So what we are acquiring here, we are acquiring the photomultiplier and the CMOS images, and we are analyzing this data separately in order to measure two things. So first, this is the results. And I think that, as the slide says, eyes and waveform can lie. So first of all, on the left, you see exactly what I was telling you. These are alpha particles. Alpha particles travel straight and release a lot of energy. These are 5 MeV particles. These are particles, so the tracks that you see there, doesn't seem so, but they have the same amount of light, and you see by yourself how much the diffusion is reduced. It's impressive. When we saw this, it was like, and you see that it's just with addition of 1.6%, okay? Okay, so these other two things show another feature of this object. So since these are ions, and they have masses 100 times bigger than electrons, they also travel 100 times slower than electrons, okay? So your time signal for the BMT and for the GM preamp will be order of milliseconds rather than microseconds like you would expect with electron. This also implies that if you work to measure the Z with a sampling, this gives you an unprecedented resolution along Z, because you can sample at the level of nanoseconds with an oscilloscope or any other possible data acquisition, okay? So this is also an addition, okay, to this. If you want, I can give you details how we did. So this is how this strange PMT waveform appear. I can give you the details on how we did it, and this was the work of another of my PhD students. But we managed to measure the drift velocity from our data. So what we have is that we have this alpha particle that is between two rings, okay? So the maximum spread that he can have inside the detector can be known by the measurement of electron drift, which is known, and which we measure the drift velocity. And from this, we measure the velocity and a mobility that is consistent between our mixture and other published data with the same mixture, okay, still by me, but okay. But with a completely different setup and a charge readout. But this is not the impressive part. The impressive part is another, and is what is the analysis, what the analysis of the CMOS images give us. So how I do to extract the diffusion from these images? And when I say I do, it's because I did this analysis. So I'm very proud, I really did the analysis en route. So what do you do is that you take the single, you take the tracks, okay? You assume that at the production point, the tracks were like a delta, okay? Okay, tracks are not really a delta, but they have width, intrinsic width of like 20 microns, okay? So this is subdominant on the other contribution. So you assume that the original track is like a straight track. Then you select the central part of each track, you see? You take the transverse profile of the track, you fit it, and you say that the transverse profile, the sigma of the transverse profile, represents the diffusion. Okay? So that is it. Okay, now no picture, I'm not joking, no picture. So this is what we did. Okay, so on the left there is a classic electron drift. So what you are seeing here is what? Is this sigma, so this, the transverse profile of this track, measured as a function of the distance and as a function of different drift field. The higher the drift field, the lower the diffusion, no? Because things are pushed strongly together. And this is what you see. On the left, to the left, you see helium CF4-6040, which is a classical mixture. And these numbers are exactly what you would expect from simulation, from what is known, from measurements that have been done in the last 30 years. So to me, this is confirming the robustness of the method that we are employed. And then you see two different the negative ion mixtures. Sorry, the table below is only for the central one because I finished this plot like yesterday night. But the point is this. You see just by yourself, by your eye, that the diffusion is suppressed in an amazing way. But how much is suppressed the diffusion? And this is the point. And this is why we really plan to submit to Nature. So what I'm showing on the left is the following. I told you that, so you can, so what is the idea, no? We know that the diffusion must go with that, the diffusion must go with this formula, okay? So we can assume that in general we can write this sigma quadro. Actually, we write it as a sum of a sigma zero, which is a term for everything that doesn't depend on the length, but we don't care about this now. Plus, this term that you can write as 2 key TF, in the sense that we are parameterizing this with F case temperature, over E and E, okay? So whenever we are at the thermal limit, if we fit for this number, we should see the correct value, which is 25.7 millivolt, okay? Then we do the fit for these three gases. We found 54 millivolt for the electron drift. This is what you would expect because it's above the thermal limit and is what you would expect for electron. We find 20 for one of our gas mixture, the one in which there is no helium. But the one in which there is helium, we find 7 millivolt instead of 25.7. So this means that we measured something that is 3.5 times below the thermal limit, which by definition is expected to be an unsurpassable limit. Okay. And this challenge, our challenge is our knowledge of the theory of transport of ion and gases. That's why we are pointing to Nature. So this observation is really, really, I mean, a game changer. We are doing so many cross checks you cannot imagine of the measurement, but I'm really convinced of this. So the point are two. On one side, we are challenging our current knowledge of transport of ion and gases. On the other side, whatever is the explanation. So we achieved the diffusion that is 3.5 times less than the thermal limit. That is the lower that you would ever expect. We have tracks like this. So this implies that from the technological and experimental point of view, whatever is the explanation, which is not my job to find, I mean, I tried to, but now after 1 year that I'm studying books, I gave up. In the end, I'm not a theoretician, especially not of gas transport. So whatever the solution is, the practical solution is that we can make tracks as tiny and as precise like this. And this will open really a new world in terms of optimization of tracking detector. So that's why I really wanted to show it to you because it's something that I'm really proud and also because I'm looking for an explanation by people because I don't have an explanation of this. This doesn't make sense. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And congratulations for these results, which I expect will have a lot of applications. So
Does anybody have an idea what are we seeing and why this is possible? how can atoms have an energy that is 4 times below the thermal energy?
Okay, with this call, which will stay on YouTube, I leave it open the discussion for afterwards. I'm very sorry, but I have to rush.
Yes.
Reason
sorry.
Why I need to stop it here. So first, let's thank the speaker for this beautiful seminar, colloquium. And let me also thank our students for keeping the discussion so lively, so really well
Grazie.
Done. I'm very proud of you and very proud of us. Okay, so then for any discussion afterwards, I encourage you to look at the recording and contact Elisabetta for questions or suggestions for interpretations, and all the best for your
Thank you.
Work.
Thank you very much also for giving me the chance to talk to you also about this other stuff going very past away what were expected the limit, but I really cared about showing you this. Thanks a lot.